Welcome back to Squawk on the Street. Despite increasing demand, the price of oil continues to fall, with energy stocks underperforming on the month, on the quarter, and the year. That said, one company is optimistic that it can return to growth in the years ahead. With that, let's get to Brian Sullivan at the Gas Tech Conference in Houston with a special guest. Hey, Brian.
Carl, thank you very much. And that special guest is the CEO and chair of Chevron, Mike Wirth. Mike, good to see you. Thanks for joining us.
Brian, it's good to be here.
Okay, well, good time to be here. A lot of people have been confused about oil and gas prices. Gas has been low forever. Oil prices below 70, not today, but they bounce back. How does Chevron grow? It's been a difficult year for investors and shareholders in a lot of energy and oil and gas companies. How does Chevron return to growth and return to growth from the Chevron equity as well?
Well, we look at the long term, so the near term price has an influence on near-term financials, but it really doesn't affect growth investments for the future. That's predicated on our view of the future. We've got this strong momentum building in our traditional business with a number of growth drivers here in the U.S., also overseas. In our new energy business, our lower carbon business, we've got project startups this year and next year, all of which underpin strong financial growth over the next several years, a 10% annual growth in free cash flow, which supports a dividend now yielding 4.5%, three times the S&P, a strong and consistent share repurchase program, and a commitment to return cash to shareholders, which really gets to the equity value and the proposition for investors.
You know, there's this, I think for the first time ever or in a long time, traders are net short oil contracts. They believe that oil is down. The bearishness in oil is unbelievable right now. The idea that there's just going to be too much oil in the world to meet demand, especially if OPEC comes back online by adding more barrels over the next year or so. Do you have a view as to where the price of crude is going to go the next 2 to 5 years, Mike?
You know, we have to have planning scenarios, and so we look at different scenarios. A lot of this, it's dependent upon the fundamentals. Supply has been pretty strong. We've seen growth in supply primarily in the Americas. We've got OPEC with some capacity offline, and demand has been a little less, I think, than most people expected. As we see a slowing economy here, we've seen slower growth in China than I think most people expected. And so it's a market that right now looks well supplied with some capacity held back. So I think that really explains the near-term outlook that you see out of
people. You've been adding production in the Permian. Are you surprised that the U.S. is at record oil production? I don't think anybody would have thought in 2024 that the U.S. would have been at 13.3, 13.4 million barrels a day.
Well, we've added, just started up a project last month in the deep water Gulf of Mexico.
The Anchor Project.
The Anchor Project, the first ever to get into a 20,000 pound per square inch regime of subsurface pressure, which is essentially equivalent to an elephant standing on a quarter. So new technology breakthroughs in a number
of quarter, but it sounds, is that good? I don't know what that means.
It's high pressure.
Is bad for the quarter? Is that good for Chevron?
It's good for Chevron because and it's good for the U.S. because it opens up a new regime for us to explore and produce resources here in this country, in the deepwater Gulf of Mexico, which has a lot of running room left ahead of it. Permian Basin, we've been running ahead of our plans. In fact, we've upped our guidance for this year. Expect to be at 1 million barrels a day, just Chevron in production in 2025. We're producing 400,000 barrels a day in the DJ Basin. The U.S. continues to be an energy superpower, and we've got lots of resource in this country, important for our economy, important for the competitiveness of the U.S.
This new deepwater platform, which we, as an anchor, I like the name. It's the anchor. Yeah. These projects are expensive, and they take years to develop. You've got this huge new project in Kazakhstan that you've invested in over time. Tomorrow is Fed Day. I know. You know, 25 or 50, but it's everybody's talking about it. As somebody that allocates capital over years, you don't think in months, you think in decades. Do interest rates matter more or less than the price of oil for long-term CapEx decisions?
Well, long-term CapEx is really grounded in a view of GDP growth, population growth, energy development in economies. A growing middle class consumes more energy, and more than near-term interest rates, what really is important is policy stability, an investment environment that we can invest in for decades with some confidence that we understand what the rules of the road will be, and we can invest with confidence, which calls for a real balanced view of the drivers of economic prosperity, energy security, and environmental protection.
Do we have a view right now under either administration that potentially wins? I mean, obviously, Trump had been in office before, but we have a new administration possibly as well with Harris. Do you have visibility into what that might look like from an energy policy perspective?
Well, I think former President Trump's policy views are fairly well known from his time in office. You know, we've been pleasantly surprised to see Vice President Harris with some views that are a little different than perhaps what we might have expected from her, a recognition that energy is important to our economy and that some of the technologies that are used in energy production should be encouraged, not discouraged.
Okay. I appreciate your time, Mark. I know we didn't get into it. You got this amazing new hydrogen project coming in Utah. The same as all the batteries in America combined, very quickly.
The hydrogen storage at our green hydrogen project in Utah will be three times all the grid-connected battery storage in the U.S. combined.
Putting hydrogen, Mike Moore, thank you very much. David Faber, think about that. Just shoving hydrogen into salt caverns in Utah is a bigger battery than all the actual batteries that currently exist in the United States. I could see a David Faber Utah desert week-long road trip journey in our future. Guys, I'll send it back to you in New York. Thank you very much.